Welcome to the workflow tutorial for MetaHuman Animator. MetaHuman Animator is a feature set available in the MetaHuman from Unreal Engine plugin. This update requires Unreal Engine 5.2 and the latest version of the MetaHuman rig. We also updated the Live Link Face iOS application, enabling the capture of video in depth through the front-facing cameras. Today we'll focus on streamlined in-editor workflow. For more technical details, you can always look at the new MetaHuman section on the Epic Developer Community website. Let's get started. All of the assets that we'll be showing can be found in the MetaHuman Animator submenu under Advanced Assets. An additional tool, the Capture Manager, can be found under the Tools top menu. The data and workflow for performance capture are heavy on media. If you can spare them, allocating resources to caching can make things much smoother. We recommend using a global cache, giving it 4 threads, and at least a couple of gigabytes of system memory. Preparing the footage for use requires that the system has information about the device that captured it. We added a new asset called the Capture Source. Capture sources represent device and calibration data. You need one capture source for each calibration used by a given device. iPhone devices are factory calibrated, which means just one asset for each physical device is enough. iPhone capture sources can work two ways. In connected mode, we configure the IP of the device, and with Live Link Face active in the foreground on the device, we could ingest directly from it. Alternatively, and what we're using here, they can be in archive mode, where footage has already been downloaded, and a path is set to a location containing one or more takes. With the capture source configured, the next step is ingesting the takes, which is done from the capture manager. To the left, we have a list of all capture sources in the project with icons indicating the device type and status. We can select our source and see the takes on it. We can select takes, configure the destination path for the media at the bottom, which would apply to all takes selected if there were multiple, and then add them to the queue presented to the right. Adding to the queue will not automatically start processing or importing. Once everything is queued, import all will start ingesting. Processing large volumes of footage can take a while and create an abundance of assets, which is why there is an option to automatically save the new assets as the queue moves forward. After footage ingestion, the target folder will contain a subfolder with a capture source name. That's meant to prevent name clashes when multiple capture sources contain same name takes. Inside, we have a capture data asset and a similarly named folder. References to data and metadata are bundled together in the capture data asset, and the folder by its side in turn contains the finer grain assets produced by the ingest process. MetaHuman faces are encoded by what we call MetaHuman DNA, and the toolkit to calibrate it is in the MetaHuman Identity asset. With this release, Mesh to MetaHuman has been extended to work with footage. Components from footage will configure the component tree directly from the capture data we choose, and then we can select the neutral pose and use the guided workflow toolbar at the top. We're looking for a frontal view first. We want a relaxed expression, open eyes staring straight ahead, and a closed mouth with the seal of the lips in view and no gaps. All of these parameters affect the rig's rest state in its neutral pose. No matter the capture device class, you always need a frontal frame. The first frame you promote will automatically be flagged as frontal, but this is something you can change later. With professional-grade stereo cameras, the frontal frame alone is sufficient. With iPhone footage, we could use just a frontal frame, but it is better to complement it with two additional angles. These will help with the accuracy of the calibration. More than 3 frames are usually counterproductive. You still want these frames to show a relaxed neutral pose, but the gaze becomes irrelevant as it's derived from the frontal frame alone. The same markers should be visible in all 3 frames. It is best to stick to the auto-tracking set of markers that's visible by default. The region covered by auto-tracking is all you need for excellent performance capture. Once your frames are tracked, you can perform a mesh solve to conform the template mesh to the capture data. To help with inspecting the fidelity of results, we have added 2 new view modes. All view modes have 2 configurable buffers. But beyond the original toggle option we had before, we have added a wipe mode with blend control and the dual pane view. Markers display and viewport manipulation are only available in the single pane toggle mode, but for inspection, the other 2 can be immensely helpful. Next, we want to calibrate the MetaHuman DNA and rig for the performer. You can set off auto-rigging and add the results as a new MetaHuman to your MetaHuman Creator library, as before. Or you can choose to only retrieve the data without encumbering your collection with every attempt you make. This is the one instance where authentication with our backend is necessary, so make sure that you are logged in with your Epic and Bridge credentials. For the mandatory steps, once your MetaHuman services will have returned a rig to your project, that is it. But an optional one is highly recommended, adding a thief pose. Adding a thief pose registers the thief position inside the head and improves the animation solved by the MetaHuman performance asset considerably. Heads up, this is an operation run locally in your project. If you added a MetaHuman to your library from the neutral pose, that MetaHuman's byte might be subtly different from the one in your project after you will have fit the thief. We can add this new pose from the component tree menu. Then look for a frontal frame to promote where the performer is bearing their teeth. We want to clearly see the corners of two incisors and as much of the teeth surface as possible. This pose only requires the one frontal frame and there is no reason to add more. Most of the time, you will only see either the upper or lower incisors, depending on the bite. Keep the markers for the visible incisors active and deactivate the other two from the markers outliner. Regardless of the teeth pose presence, if we want to use our work to solve animation, we need to prepare the asset for performance. This is a computationally intensive process and it will take a few minutes. How long exactly depends on your hardware, but you only need to run this once for any given performer. Lastly, during the setup process, a skeletal mesh was created alongside our asset and configured by the auto-rigging step. The skeletal mesh can be useful in its own right, but we recommend that it is not modified while being used for performance capture work. Duplicate it and use the duplicate if you wish to use it outside of the MetaHuman Animator workflow. We're finally at the keystone of MetaHuman Animator, the MetaHuman performance asset. The most practical way to describe what it does is that it takes frames of footage, a MetaHuman rig calibrated to the performer in that footage, and produces keyframes of facial animation. Configuring the asset is trivially simple. Set the footage attribute to reference captured data containing the performance, and the MetaHuman identity attribute to reference what you calibrated on the performer that is in that footage. Set the start and end frames to the slice of time you want to process, and if you want neck movement from the solver, ensure that range includes at least one frontal frame for the system to find and use as a reference pose. And that is it. Everything is automated. All you have to do from here is press the process button. As the footage is tracked and solved, you will see several progress in preview stages, and after a while, the animation will be available for you to play and inspect in the asset. If you're happy with the results you see in the viewport, this is where the plugin stops, and your Real Engine Editor comes back into play. You have two options to go back out to Engine. To quickly assemble the source data together with the results in one place, you can export the level sequence. The option should be fairly self-explanatory, and as you can see, this gets you fairly close to the MetaHuman Performance Asset viewport, but directly inside the engine, in your level. The other option, which is likely to be the most common end target, is to export an animation sequence. Inside the MetaHuman Performance Asset, the animation is mapped to the Performer's rig, which is a subset of the full MetaHuman rig, and therefore technically different. Don't worry though, the difference is purely technicality. In reality, the rigs are semantically identical. At export time, you can choose any MetaHuman as a target, and animation will work flawlessly on it. We only have a couple of things left to say. Because of the semantic parameter space of our rigs, animation will always move correctly across any MetaHuman compatible rigs, and adding it to one is as simple as adding a face tracking sequencer.
Hello, and welcome to the tutorial for MetaHuman Animator.
And a belated welcome from Ada here, if anybody was wondering what the line was. And last but not least, as first exported, the animation will be on the rig logic channels, which is great for inspection or processing raw data, but will be frustrating for an animator to do anything useful with. Not to worry, at any point, animation can be back solved to the control rig faceboard. Right-click the track, choose the bait to control rig, select the face board, pick your options, and let it work. Now, of course, throughout the video, many of the waits during processing and solving were sped up. We assume you have better things to do than watching progress bars in a tutorial. But every single click and keystroke in the workflow has been left unaltered. We are absolutely positive that the ability to do end-to-end performance capture with just 10 minutes of actual work will lead to some amazing content. We can't wait to see what you'll create with this. Thank you very much for watching.